Open up heaven. Open up heaven. Yeah, yeah.
Open up heaven.
That's our desire tonight. Open up your mouths all over this room. Open up heaven. Open up heaven. Open up heaven. Oh, we bless you, God. Oh, we need your power, God. Yeah. We receive your miracles, signs and wonders. Oh. Open heaven, open heaven. There's a river of miracles flowing. There's a river of miracles flowing. Say,
there's a river.
Can you say that?
Everybody ready for the word this morning? I am ready for the word. Rhonda, if you could put my screen back up there for me, please. Amen. We started a series on believe, be trained, belong, become, and then build, right? How many know that scripture in Romans chapter number 8, verse 19, it said that we have been predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, right? And so what that means is that your destiny is not to be doctors and lawyers and basketball players and football players and carpenters or musicians. Your destiny has nothing to do with your occupation, your hobby, or anything that you identify with. It has nothing to do with that. Your destiny and God's plan for your life has everything to do with being conformed to the image of his son. In other words, your destiny has everything to do with you becoming like Jesus. That's what your destiny is. Now, our job, our career, our hobbies, the things that we do, they are different ways that we display the image of God through us, all right? And so I'm not saying that you should not do those things, but God will cause you to do those things in such a godly way that people will see God when you're doing those things. Does that make sense? And so our destiny is to be conformed to the image of his son. And we talked about this on last week. I just want to touch on it just a little bit. Amen. The first step in becoming a child of God is you have to believe, right? Because we learned last week that people don't go to someone unless they believe that person can solve their problem. Come on, somebody. You don't go to the bank unless you believe that bank got money for you. Come on, somebody. You don't go to the doctor unless you believe that doctor can do something to help you with your health, right? And so when you come to Jesus or you come to God, you must believe that he can. Belief is not optional. You must believe. That's what Hebrews says. It says, without faith, it is impossible to please him. But those that come to him, they must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. That scripture right there is powerful right there. Because you got to believe that he is. You have to first believe that God is real and that God can reward you with what you're asking him for. I'm convinced that many people believe in God. They just don't believe in themselves. That's the biggest issue right there. You believe in God, but you don't believe that God will do it for you. Because you're measuring yourself by other people instead of by measuring yourself by who you are as an individual. And God is no respecter of the person. If you work the principle, then the principle, it has to work for you. But because you're a different individual, it's not going to work in the same way. So it makes no sense to be looking for your results to be the same results as somebody else. I'm gonna kill that copycat spirit around here where people are saying, God, I wish you would bless me like you blessed him. I want me a husband like she got. I want me a wife like she got. I want me a car like he got. I want me a house. No, listen, God, you already pre-planned my life. I want what you have destined for me to have. And the Bible says, amen, that God's plans for you, it says the promises of God are yes and amen. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, it says, whatsoever ye desire when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you what? You will have them. So not only has God pre-planned certain things for your life, and he's already prepared things for you. He also said, I'll give you the desires of your heart.
Yes, hallelujah.
So it makes no sense to be looking after somebody, what somebody else got, when God already has certain things with your name on it.
Right.
But if you don't believe, somebody shout, believe.
Believe.
You can't have it. You can't have it. Come on, somebody. How many of you think that you will get, amen, the money out of the bank that is rightfully yours because you put it in there? How many of you think that you will get that money out of the bank if you don't go to it? Huh? The only way you get money out that you put in it is you got to go to the bank and get it out. Huh? But there is a procedure, is there not? There's a procedure for getting your money out of the bank. And there is a procedure, amen, to getting the things that God has for you. And that first thing is, you must believe. You must believe. And I tell you, amen, sometimes believing is hard, is easier said than done. But you have to learn to discipline yourself to believe. Does that make sense? You got to learn to discipline yourself. You got to fight away the doubts. And you got to fight away the discouragement. You got to fight against those unmet expectations that you had, amen, before. You know, people don't see, people say, well, I ain't going to try again because last time it didn't work. No, you need to try that thing again. That's a part of belief. Let me just throw this in, and that's not what I'm planning. We plan to talk about being trained today. But I need to throw this in here because the Lord showed this to me this week, and I need to give it to you real quick. You need to understand how powerful prayer is. You need to understand how powerful prayer is. Here is how powerful prayer is. First of all, is the Bible says when it came to Daniel, that the Bible says that the angels heard Daniel the first time he prayed. Come on, the first time he prayed, the angel said, I heard you the first time you prayed. But they got resistance, right, in trying to bring into pass what Daniel had prayed for. Now watch this, because the Bible says that the angels, watch this, the Bible says that the angels, they hearkened to the voice of the word. They hearken to the voice of the word, and the Bible says that angels are ministering spirits sent to minister for the saints.
Amen.
So angels work for you. Some of y'all angels is overweight and fat because you ain't said nothing. Come on, somebody. They sitting on their lazy boy chair, amen, watching the soap operas or watching 60 Minutes. Come on, somebody. Because you ain't put them to work. They are meant to work for you. Remember I told you that the kingdom of God is voice activated. So when you pray, the angels begin to go and work to get that, to bring that thing to pass that you prayed for. But watch this with Daniel. The Bible says that the angels got, they got some resistance from the prince of Persia, because there are angels. And there's an opposite force, right? All right, so they said they got resistance. Now, if angels work on the behalf of the believer when you pray, what happens to the angels? What do the angels do when you stop praying? They stop working. And the Bible says that Daniel continued to pray and pray and pray and pray and pray until finally the angels broke through. Some of the stuff that we have given up on, you didn't get because you gave up. Wasn't because God didn't grant it to you. Come on, somebody. Wasn't because the angels wasn't working for you. They quit because you quit. That's why the scripture says to pray without ceasing. Every day you need to be saying something, amen, kingdom activating those angels working on your behalf. Y'all believe that this morning? Come on, clap your hands. That ain't what I came to preach this morning, but I had to give it to you. All right. to be trained? Why do I have to be trained? Because the kingdom is a different government, and it operates on different principles. Though there are some similarities in how we do things here in America, America is not the kingdom of God. Come on, somebody. I ain't gonna get on that stuff. You have dual citizenship. Huh? And so you have to be trained in how to operate the kingdom, just like if you get a new job, every time you get a new job, what they do? They train you. Why? Because though we may do something similar, we don't do all things the same way. You can go from working at McDonald's and then work at Burger King. Guess what? You still got to get. Why? Because it is a different system. And when it comes to the kingdom of God, you've got to learn the system and how it works. Listen, let me tell you this. God does not get moved by tears. God does not get moved, amen, by you crying and weeping and pouting. God don't get moved by that. My kids used to get so mad at me, they used to pout and say, I don't get moved by that. I don't get moved by that. No, no. You do what you're supposed to do, and then what you need to get done, that is how it happens. That's how it happens, y'all. Huh? Your job. They don't get moved by your tears. Now, if you can operate that, if you can operate your job outside of your tears, because what you understand that if I'm going to get paid, I got to do what these folks are asking me to do. And 9 times out of 10, you don't want to do what they ask you to do. But you do it why? Because you want to get paid. Well, we've got to get trained in how the kingdom works, so we can actually get kingdom results. And don't get mad at the person that's getting kingdom results. They ain't doing nothing but working these principles right here. God is no respecter of persons. Everybody that you see, amen, that's getting kingdom results, they're going to say, look, I had to put some blood, sweat, and tears into this. Don't be mad at me because I decided to be obedient. But we've got to learn to be trained. That's why in Proverbs 22, verse 6, the scripture says, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Why? Rhonda, can you put up that one picture with education versus training? They are different. Did you know that? The education versus education and training is different. College and universities, they teach you theory. Just stories, stuff that just might happen. Stuff that just, somebody else said. Theories, sometimes unproven theories. Sometimes unproven theory, but they give you theory. Training is much different. See if I can find it here until she can get that up there. I thought I put it in here. All right. Did you get it up there? Okay. All right. But training is much different. Training gives you practical demonstration. Practical demonstration. When you get trained in something, they actually let you try. That should give you an opportunity to apply what you have learned. I ain't gonna talk about it. I believe in education, praise God. But I mean, our higher education system, in my opinion, is the biggest ripoff in the entire world. Because you spend all of that money going to get this theory. Come on, somebody. And then when you go to apply for the job, you still got to go and get trained. Well, why did I spend all this money to? Let me leave that alone. So Jesus, his model was training. His model was training. He said, I got to train you to do what it is I want you to do. That's why in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus told the disciples, He said, listen, he said, I'm going to give you power first, which God has already blessed all of us with power, gave it to you by the Holy Ghost, right? And then he says, go and heal the sick. Go and cast out demons. Go and open blinded eyes. They didn't have to pay for it. All right? That's the first of all. They didn't have to pay for it. Praise God. Amen. But they went, amen, and did what he had given them power to do as he was right there doing it with them. Training, practical application, training, demonstration, training, amen, where he teaches you how to do it and why you're doing it. Versus just a bunch of theory, all right? So to train someone, you do it through repetition, right? Huh? Our teacher here, I got any teachers in here? No, I got one teacher in here, okay. Teachers understand that people learn through repetition, right? But they don't learn through continually hearing. There it is. There we go. We got it. They don't learn through continually hearing. Eventually, they have to learn to continually do what it is that you're trying to get them to do, right? And so I used to hate it. Man, I already got this math problem. Why I got to do all these practical exercises? Why? Because they're trying to train you on the system of how to come up with the correct answer. And you need to learn to be trained. Here's what training is versus education. Training is the pursuit of ability. Education is the pursuit of knowledge. Training improves performance and productivity. Education develops a sense of reasoning and judgment. Training, method of skill development. Education, method of gaining knowledge. Training teaches certain tasks. Education teaches general concepts. Training gives you practical application. Education, theoretical orientation. Training, short-term process. Education, long-term process. Training, a narrow scope. Education is a wide scope. I prefer training. Come on, somebody. Yeah. Huh? Especially for that one that says it improves performance and productivity. How many? I know some of y'all in here. You might not admit it, but I know I got in here some professional students up in here. Come on, somebody. You got about 4 or 5 degrees. You're just a professional student. You like to keep learning. You enjoy, amen, learning. Nothing wrong with enjoying learning, but eventually there needs to be some productivity out of what you have learned. And I see more, it's not that learning is wrong, but some people get stuck there, and it's not because you have not learned, it's because you don't have confidence in yourself to do. So what you do is every time somebody asks you to do something, you feel like you need more training. You feel like you need more knowledge. It's not that you need more knowledge or training. It's not that you don't have the ability. You don't have the confidence in yourself. In other words, you don't believe in yourself. You got to believe in God, then also believe in the God in you. God doesn't give you the Holy Ghost. He doesn't give you power for you to continue learning. He gives you power to use what he gave you to get some results. Lord, have mercy. Let me leave that alone. Hallelujah. Praise the train up a child in the way that he should go. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. Galatians 4:1-4 says, now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all. But he is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Even so, when we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent his son, made of a woman, made under the law. Do you not understand that your whole life, at the beginning of your salvation, is about you being trained to be a child of God? God. And then there comes a time when God is going to say, now go. And it's not going to be time where I need to learn some more. No. God does not bring you into the kingdom just to learn. He doesn't bring you into the kingdom just to sit in the chairs at church and have a good time. At the end, eventually, there's going to come a fullness of time where God is going to expect you to deliver on the investment that he's made in your life. I said it last week. Listen, I'm done. I got one more. My daughter is 17. She's almost 18. Amen. She lives with her mother right now. But my kids, hey, listen, there ain't gonna be no 40-year-old children living in my house. I trained you. I did the best I could. Now you got to get out there and perform. I'm going to love you while you're out there trying to perform. I'm going to love you while you're out there failing. Come on, somebody. I'm going to love you while you're out there trying. I'm going to love you while you're out there struggling. Amen. But you'll never learn, amen, and you'll never get where you want to be until you try.
That's right.
You got to try. How many of us, amen, made our children get on that bike? It's time to learn to ride a bike.
That's right.
Huh? And the whole, most of us, man, wanted to get back to our TV show. So you're trying to hurry them up and learning how to ride this bike. I'm outside with you. I want to be watching TV. I got other things to do. Hurry up and learn how to ride this bike. Huh? So watch this. So when they try and they fall, what you do? Get on back on that bike, boy. Get on back on that bike. You're going to learn today. Ain't no tomorrow. You're going to learn today. Come on, somebody. Huh? That's how God is with us. That's why so many of you, God keeps bringing up to you what you're supposed to be doing.
Well,
God's trying to get you to learn to ride that bike.
Jesus.
And he won't move. He won't move to another subject. He won't move to another thing. The only thing God talking to you about what he asked you to do 10 years ago that you still haven't done. Because you can't pass this step. You need this training. You need to be able to do this before you can get to the next step. Ephesians chapter number 4. Watch it. No. In Galatians 4, watch what it says. It says, but it's under tutors and governors. Everybody needs a teacher.
That's right.
Everybody needs somebody who will train them. I have several mentors. These mentors that I have, they give me different things because I don't believe that one person can give you everything that you need. I get on that in a minute. Huh? Huh? You know, you got this one teacher that you've been loyal to because they helped you. They was there for you, amen, as a child, amen. But now that you're an adult, you still looking to them for guidance, and you on the same level as them. No, I'm trying to get to the next level. So you can't help me get there because you ain't been there.
That's right.
Come on, somebody. Huh? Tutors and governors. Do you not know in Britain the royal children, as soon as they come out the womb, that nanny is ready.
Right there.
Hmm? Royal children, as soon as they come out the womb, that nanny is ready. The whole entourage, the whole team, not just one person, there's a team of people that train that child from birth all the way to adulthood on how to be a royal child. They don't go to regular school. Oh, man, I can't get on that. They don't go to regular school. Why? Because I'm a royalty. I'm different from everybody. The Bible says that you are a chosen people, a what? Royal priesthood. So royal children get trained from birth all the way up to adulthood. Everybody needs somebody that's training. Who's training you? Who's teaching you? I talked to Apostle Scales. Though he is 60, almost 70 years old, he still has someone that is teaching and training him. He goes and listens to Apostle Fred Price, and that is who teaches him, and that's who he goes to. Still, at 60, 70 years old, still somebody is teaching and training him, and he's pouring into him. You never get too old. You never get too smart for somebody to train you. Why? Because people are experts in different areas. Why you still listening to that person that's just as broke as you are about money? That's why you stay broke. Yeah. When you start listening to people that got more money than you, come on somebody, then your money start coming up. Oh, come on, I done touched a nerve. Huh? But what we like to do is we like to hang out with the people that are in the same situation so we all can have a pity party together. That same time that you're having a pity party with your friends, you could be at somebody else's house learning and being trained on how to come up to the next level. Come on, somebody. We started, my wife and I, we got together with some of our friends. We got, man, friends, one particular couple, man, she sent us this whole budget worksheet. I mean, this thing is massive. And I said, y'all do that for your household? Yes.
Come on.
But it takes discipline to go to the next level.
Yeah.
You can't do what you were doing before and get new results.
Come on,
somebody. You can't stop at McDonald's every time you get hungry when you know you got food at the house. Oh, don't act like I'm by myself. Don't make me, I am by myself. Huh? If you plan to have more money, get around some people that are doing what you believe God has called you to do and be trained. Ephesians 4:11-16, and he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. Watch this. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. The fivefold ministry is people are supposed to be training you. This is why, amen, I can't wait. We're going to get started next year. Amen. I want to know everything everybody does. I want to know where you work at. Not so I can call your job and tell them how bad of a member of a church you are. And that's not why I want to know what you do. I want to know what your expertise is.
All right.
So that if somebody comes to me and say, Pastor, I need help in this area. Let me look down through my database right here and say, okay, all right. Oh, this person right here, this person is an expert in this area. Why don't you go and connect with them and learn from them? Huh? But you gotta swallow your pride when you do that. Huh? I don't have pride when it comes to my money. Oh, y'all hear that? I don't have pride when it comes to my money. I'm trying to get more. I don't have pride when it comes to my children. I want my children to be blessed. I want my children to have everything that they can. I don't have pride with that. If I'm having a problem, I need to find an answer. And if God ain't telling me, somebody got an answer. People, when they have pride concerning their needs go unmet. Five minutes for is for the perfecting, for the maturing of the saints. Not just so we can come to church and have a good time. I love seeing y'all. I love fellowshipping with y'all. But I don't get giggles. I don't get a good feeling just because we came together. The greatest feeling I have is when I see you going to the next level. When I see you this time next year, and this time next year you was in the project today, but come next year you in your own house. Yeah. Come on, you were single today. Come next year you married and got a family. Oh, y'all act like y'all don't want to be married. Y'all just ladies, y'all know better than that. See. All them years of not being married, now y'all's expectation has gone down. Y'all pray for Serena, Lord. Y'all pray for Serena.
And my future husband.
Amen. Praise God. Let me close with this. Joshua was trained under Moses. Right? He was trained under Moses. He helped Moses with his with delivering the children of Israel out of Egypt. But Joshua's assignment was different than Moses, but it was connected. Y'all remember in Joshua chapter 1? Let's go there real quick, and I need to show you this, and we're going to get, we'll keep moving. Joshua chapter number 1. Joshua was trained under Moses. Moses trained him. Joshua verse 1 says, "Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel, every place that the sole of your feet shall tread upon, that I have given you, as I said unto Moses." So Joshua was trained under Moses, and Joshua got what Moses didn't get. Moses got the children of Israel out of Egypt. Joshua got the children of Israel into the promised land. But Joshua's destiny and Joshua's assignment was directly connected to Moses, because God kept telling Joshua, he said, "Do as I told Moses to do." Because sometimes your trainer will leave their inheritance to you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And that's why you got to be careful with who you call father. Y'all need to be aligned in the spirit. You need to be aligned with your giftings. You need to be aligned in the road and the path that you are going. Come on, somebody. Joshua, all right? So listen, this is what I'm saying now. Don't abandon your teacher or your father because of that very reason. Because it may be that God, amen, have assigned you to carry on that vision. Elisha was trained by Elijah and got a double portion.
Yes, he did.
What does that mean? That means that Elisha did twice as much as what Elijah did because he submitted to training. He worked twice as many miracles as Elijah did because he submitted to being trained. Last one. David, watch this, was trained by his friend Jonathan. David was a great warrior, but when God had anointed him king, David didn't have any king etiquette. Huh? He didn't know how to hang out among royalty because he wasn't brought up that way. Jonathan was brought up in the king's house, so he understood royal etiquette. Come on, somebody. Amen. And sometimes God may put you in a position, amen, where you don't understand the protocols or the etiquette, and you need somebody to train you. Don't ask God amen, to give you something that you don't deserve, that you're not qualified for, and then you won't submit to training when God gives it to you. Watch this though. Here's the great thing. Here's the great thing. If Jonathan was David's peer, and wouldn't it be something if we could learn from our peers? That we weren't in such competition with one another, and that you could see that your peer is doing something excellent in a particular area, and you lay down your pride and say, please, will you teach me about what you're doing in this area? It's not that they are better than you in every area. They're better than you in that area. I don't know how many times I've called some of my friends and said, hey, man, what are you doing? How are you doing that? I like what you're doing. I can't do it the same way, but I need to understand the principles and the schematics of how you're doing that so that I can maybe try to do that as well. Because I see it's working for you. If it's working for you, it might work for me. Being trained by your peers. How many of you got any peers that are better than you in an area? Raise your hand. Have you asked them for help? Ooh. Pride. Competition. I'm trying to kill it. I ain't in competition with nobody but myself. I'm too unique to be in competition with anybody. I don't think like people. I don't talk like other people. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. I'm not a copycat of anyone.
That's right. Come on.
But I understand that principles work no matter who works it. Now you can keep your pride and stay broke, busted, and disgusted. Stay depressed. Stay wherever you at, or you can submit to being trained in that area that you need to be trained. I remember when my wife and I, a couple years ago, we wanted to buy a house, but our credit was jacked up. And my wife said, wait a minute, I know somebody that is an expert in credit. And she called her up. This is a friend of hers. We sat down with this person, and watch this, and we paid her for her expertise, though she was a friend. And we just got into our new house last month in November. Come on, somebody. Why? Because we submitted to training. That's the next step. You gotta believe God. Then find somebody that is doing what you believe God has called you to do and submit to being trained. I ain't say submit to being ran over. I ain't say submit to being used. I ain't say none of that. I said submit to being trained. Somebody that will teach you what to do and how to do it. Not just give you a bunch of theoretical education. Somebody that will actually give you opportunities to practice. And then give you some feedback after they have observed you practicing. They used to call me Apostle Scales stalker. Because I would just show up at places that Apostle Scales would be ministering at, around the city or around the area. And I would just show up. And when he would see me, I would be there before him. And it's hard to beat him there because he's there a half hour before the church service starts. So that means I'm there an hour before the service starts. Apostle Scales, when it comes to time, he will totally embarrass you. You hear me? So I'm there an hour before the service starts. I remember I went to a funeral one time. Apostle Scales was doing a funeral, and he didn't know this particular person. But, you know, they asked him to do the funeral. So I'm there an hour before the funeral starts. And Apostle Scales pulls up a half hour before the funeral starts. I know his pattern. Come on, somebody, right? And so he sees me there before him. He just looks at me and smiles. You know? So I go to grab his badge and Bible. Although he doesn't like people to do that, he doesn't require that of me. But I did that because I'm the trainee. I'm the servant, right? And so I go, and he's doing this this funeral, and he doesn't know this person. Now, I've not done as many funerals as him, so I'm watching him do this funeral, and I noticed during the time when he got up to do the eulogy that he basically took what the family said about that person, right? And God gave him some scriptures right there on the spot. Gave him some scriptures to use to wrap the whole thing up about what the family said about that person. I was like, wow, how did you do that? You know what I'm saying? But I was able to connect with that person, said this about the person, this person said this about the person, and he added all of that in, grabbed some scriptures out the blue, you know, and put it on. It was beautiful. And so then I talked to him about it, and he said, well, yeah, that's what the Holy Spirit gave me during that time. It wasn't intentional, but that's what the Holy Ghost led me to do, you know. But so I learned that, so now if I do a funeral for somebody I don't know, I got a template for what I need to do. I don't have to be stressing out, pulling my hair about, what am I going to say about this person?
Yeah, exactly. Come on. That's good. That's that training.
Being trained. Other times, when I'm gone, he goes somewhere to minister, I just show up. He'll call me up and say, you know, once you pray, or once you give a word of exhortation, once you prophesy to this person or that person, gave me opportunities to practice in his presence so he could get feedback.
Come on.
Submit to training. Find somebody and you can submit to and say, will you please train me in the area that I need, in this area that I need help in. Can we say amen to that?
Amen.
Come on, clap your hands and give them praise this morning. Repeat after me. Say, this time next year, you're going to have to learn me all over again. Because I'm going from faith to faith and glory to glory, and the kingdom of God, it will manifest in my life because I'm going to submit to training. Come on, clap your hands and give them praise this morning. Hallelujah.